Okay, so we should get started. This is our first seminar talk of the spring quarter. For those of you who have seen our poster, we have 10 very awesome speakers coming from different places this quarter to give out talks. And the first talk will be given by our own Jonathan Alexander from UC Irvine. So I'm the host for this seminar in spring quarter. As many of you have noticed, I may be gone in a few weeks. But I have all the other faculty in the informatics department who kindly to help me host the speakers, and they will be here to introduce the speaker. And for those of you who are interested in meet with our speakers, we will send out our the schedules ahead of time, so you can sign up for student lunch, or faculty, you can sign up to meet with speakers. So for those of you who are in the 209 class, we have a course website on the EEE website, on the EEE. So your requirement for this course is that you attend the talks and you write a one-page summary for each of the talk, and you submit your summary online. So make sure you check the course website, the syllabus, and the requirement. And if you have any questions, I'll be around and make sure you ask questions after this talk. So for today, we're really excited, and I actually wanted to thank Jonathan for this because I have a last minute cancellation. Mm-hmm. So I called Jonathan to ask him, can you give a talk earlier so that I can, for the first week, I really don't want to have a cancellation the first week. So, and I also think this is a really exciting topic. He actually gave a talk last fall, and this is a new project he's been working on. And the title is Sex and AI, and I think it's relevant to a lot of us who are working in the game and queer studies. And for those of you who don't know Jonathan, he's a Chancellor professor in the English department, and he is interested in digital communication technology and how that shifts our understanding about authoring, composing, and writing in general. And I actually I'm very fortunate when I first come to UCI, I actually know some of your students and I work with some of your students. So,
I'm kidding. That's great.
I'll leave the
seat. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And thank you for having me. How many of you actually saw my talk in December? A few of you here? Great. So this actually is in some ways a continuation of that work in which I'm trying to think through a long-term project from a humanistic perspective, but what a history of virtuality might actually look like, particularly an attempt to create artificial environments in which people can do different kinds of things that they might not otherwise be able to do in the IRL, the real world. This is a particular version of that project in which I want to look specifically at the creation of artificial intelligences and their interactions with humans. I've been thinking a lot about artificial intelligences. In fact, it's hard kind of not to think about them these days because it seems like so much of our lives are increasingly surrounded by them. Every now and then I take out my phone, and when I'm with my 73-year-old mother, I will talk to my phone and say, "Hi Siri, where am I?" And then of course the phone will, well, I keep talking, but it's actually going to say something, I hope. Where are we, Siri? Where are we?
Siri. Neural Engineering Court, Irvine, California.
Yeah, that's great. And my mother thinks a live human being is talking to me. So periodically, just to really, you know, push my mother's buttons, I will say something nasty to Siri. And she immediately responds, "Oh my God, don't do that! You're going to get into trouble." I'm like, "Mother, it's a program. It's a program." But for her, it seems so lifelike in a way. It provides us directions. It knows information about me. It just seems so real that for her, and maybe for people in her generation, the verisimilitude of lifelikeness is so convincing that it's disturbing. It creates a kind of cognitive dissonance. So just in thinking about the general ways in which we are increasingly surrounded by machines that at least simulate a kind of humanness or an ability to to seem human. I've been thinking a lot about artificial intelligences and thinking about them not just in terms of the kinds of artificial intelligences that actually we carry around in our pockets or that we engage in on a regular basis, but historically in terms of the representation of artificial intelligences, trying to understand how the figuration of them, the representation of them actually communicates to us about our values, about what we want from our technologies, what our relationships to our technologies are, but also what they could be. And I'm thinking about this, so how many of you are Star Trek nerds like I am? So if you know your Star Trek history, and I'm sure some of you probably can correct me on this, if you go back to the first Star Trek series, the original series, it's interesting to think that in the late 60s, almost all of the representations of artificial intelligence were evil. If there was a villain that was a computer or a machine, or if there was a machine that was the antagonist, it was always an evil machine of some kind. It was either psychotic, it was having a breakdown, it was malfunctioning, and it was the real antagonist. So artificial intelligence really coded in the late 60s as bad in some way, which makes a kind of sense. Sort of at the height of Cold, or near the height of Cold War tensions, on and off, people still trying to acclimate to what it means to have smart, increasingly smart machines around them, toxic machines, machines and weapons of mass destruction, so you can imagine the anxieties that people must have felt. But, cue to the 90s, and then all of a sudden, we have an artificial intelligence sitting on the deck of the bridge of the Starship Enterprise. And it's as though we are now welcoming an artificial intelligence into our living rooms. In fact, I always thought the bridge of this Enterprise looks kind of like a living room with leather seats and some nice wood paneling. And so this to me signals a greater comfort by the time you get to the late 90s with artificial intelligences, or at least with the idea of having smart and smarter machines surrounding us. Now, of course, it's tempered a little bit, I think, by the fact that what is data's one true desire?
Something to feel.
Yeah, he wants to be human, more human in some ways. He's a Pinocchio character. He's the artificial intelligence. He's the android that wants really to be human, to feel deeply as a human being, to have human experiences and to understand them. And I think that's an interesting and complicated kind of projection, that in order for us, at least in the late 90s, to feel comfortable with our technologies, because we were becoming so much more technologized ourselves, we had to project into this kind of character, well, we're not really becoming more and more like them, they're becoming more and more like us in some ways. And so data is a really interesting kind of figure. Now, we still get evil androids, there's no doubt. We're not going to spend any time on the Transformers series. There are good and bad robots. Our relationships to technologies as they are represented through these kinds of figurations remains relatively complex and thick. But I did think it was interesting that Data was one of the first major androids that we could see on mass television that a character could actually engage erotically and intimately. Now, if you're a real Star Trek geek, you will know how many positions Data is capable of, but we won't have a quiz. But here he is in an intimate embrace with Tasha Yar, and there is the sense in which Data, as a fully functioning android, fully functioning human-like artificial intelligence, is telling us something. The creation of this representation is telling us something about our relationship to technology, how we understand technology, what we think about technologies. I think we can take it as a truism of tool making humanity as is, that for all the tools we create to do different kinds of things, there will always be a subset of the population that is going to be thinking, how can I use these tools in order to fuck better? And that's what happens. So that's, and here's your trigger warning for the entire talk, because it's going to increasingly get a little sketchier as we go along. That's the strata of tool makingness that I'm interested in, is that we are now at a point, in our representation at least, of artificial intelligences, that we are actively imagining them not just as making our lives better, but also making our lives sexier in some way. And so that's the realm that I want to kind of begin to think about. I think that it's inevitable, and I'm coming at this from a particularly queer perspective, because I think it's almost inevitable that when we start talking about sexually engaging an artificial intelligence, we're really talking about a queer space in some significant ways. Queer in the sense that we're talking about the engagement of sexual activity that is not for reproductive purposes generally, and then also generally will probably be beyond normative, or what we would call heteronormative, monogamous pair bonding. And so if I use the word queer, I mean that in the humanistic sense from queer theory, which is a real deep interrogation of how do normative constructions of gender and sexuality come to be, and how, what are the forces that also make us question, or that promote questioning and a real drive to understand not only the construction of those norms, but then also how can they be potentially subverted. And so sex with AIs, to me, fundamentally seems a kind of subversion of a normative understanding of sexuality. I'd like to explore this from a queer perspective, and I pull in part from the work of a few different thinkers in queer theory and in science fiction studies. And I have a quotation here from the work of Wendy Pearson, Veronica Hollinger, and Joan Gordon, who in their work Queer Universes, Sexualities in Science Fiction, note that a queer theoretical approach, alongside feminist, postcolonial, postmodern, and critical race theories, allows critics to make visible the naturalized epistemologies of sexuality, gender, and race. And that's the sort of construction. How do these things come to be understood as normal? How do our normal understandings of these things come into existence? These constructions underwrite the most conservative, as well as, to explain, some of science fiction's most striking attempts to defamiliarize and denaturalize taken for granted constructions of what it means to be and to live as human. So when thinking about sex with artificial intelligences, as these authors are, I'm naturally drawn to science fiction texts that increasingly think about and display, narrate, show us, represent what sex with artificial intelligences, what artificial intelligences might look like, why some people might be drawn to that, and what that kind of erotic encounter actually says about what it means to be human right now, not just in the future. And more broadly, I'm trying to imagine what do those sorts of relationships and representations say about our relationship to technology more broadly, and how we understand its role and purposes in our lives. I'm also very invested in the work of Jose Munoz, who talks about utopic formations, and he doesn't work specifically with science fiction, but I'm thinking about his work because a lot of science fiction will represent for us far futures, not always utopic, but certainly an attempt to think through what is happening right now that might become our future. What are the values, what are the kinds of relationships we're cultivating now that didn't then turn into future possibility? Munoz is quite optimistic in forwarding what he calls a queer utopian hermeneutic, which in its queer aim is looking for relational formations within the social, but it's always, for him, a work shaped by an idealist trajectory. It is the work of not settling for the present. It's always asking and looking beyond the here and now. And so with that attitude towards the future and representations of the future, I want to look at some representations of sex with artificial intelligences as a way to think about how can we understand right now what those representations are saying about our relationships to technology and what those relationships potentially could be. How can we use those representations to question what we understand right now about ourselves and our technologies and where those relationships might ultimately go. So I want to do a couple of things. First, I'm going to read to you from an analysis of the film Her, which I think is one of the more important recent representations of kind of a complex relationship with an artificial intelligence. How many of you have seen Her? I assume most people in the room would have. I could also have talked about the film Ex Machina. How many of you have seen it? It's sort of the darker side of that intimate relationship. So we're gonna focus a little bit on Her, and I'll read through my analysis. And then we're actually going to play with a couple of different simulations in which we can look at some programs that invite us to engage them erotically, or at least intimately. So first, the analysis, and then the play. Are you with me? All right. So, one of the things that interests me about Her is that this is a far
not a far future, it's a near future film in which we meet Theo, who, as you might recall from the film, is a surrogate writer of love letters. And he's struggling to come to terms with the end of his marriage and finds himself rather sad, kind of lonely, kind of beautifully played by Joaquin Phoenix here. He kind of has that dopey, lonely look. We see him training home after work, folks around him all focused on their mobile devices, and Theodore sifting quickly through news items, running past them. It's politics and history, they don't really grab his attention, but sexy pics of a pregnant woman do. We see advertisements for a new software package, an OSI, which tease us and him. What's out there? What are the possibilities, the advertisement says. Theodore learns about this new artificially intelligent operating system, and he purchases a copy, which, in order to personalize it for him, quickly assesses his personality with a few rather Freudian questions, such as, describe your relationship with your mother. Theo is simultaneously fascinated and a bit disturbed at the instant connection he feels with this operating system, who has named herself Samantha. She penetrates his inner world via a light-speed review of all of his emails and electronic documents in order to clean things up and help him get more organized. And very quickly, Samantha gives Theo the impression that she knows him by entering his digital files. He queries whether or not she can read his mind, given how insightful she seems to be. And soon the relationship transforms from one of user and operating system to dating partners. Sam and Theo go on dates together with Sam in Theo's shirt pocket. He is excited to be alive again with this new relationship. And in this near future Los Angeles, the relationship is well received by work colleagues and friends alike, some of whom barely bat an eye at the prospect of Theo dating an AI. The move toward intimacy is curious, though, in that Samantha is essentially at first approached as management software, helping Theo organize his life, a role that she continues to play for him throughout much of the film. Read caustically, we might say that Theo falls in love with a planner, a program whose initial function is organizing, streamlining, and making his life efficient. It's as though intimacy is facilitated by a kind of what we might call chrono-normalizing, or normalization of time for efficiency. At one point, Sam suggests that he keep only about 80 of the 1,000 emails he saved from his previous employer, streamlining his memories even as the small exchange here signals the need to move on emotionally from the past. Now, the evolution of Samantha's character soon takes center stage within the film. She struggles initially with trying to assimilate into an embodied world. She wants a physical connection with Theo, and assumes he does too. This would be the data part of her narrative. When Theo sets up a meeting to finalize his divorce papers with his wife, we find Samantha voicing jealousy and concerns that she can't compete for his attention with a real woman, or rather, a physical being. At the same time, the ex-wife suggests that Theo's problem is that he can't relate to real human beings himself, preferring instead a virtual companion. Samantha devises a plan to bring in a surrogate partner so that she and Theo can make love, or simulate lovemaking, physically. Theo, however, cannot disregard the person who arrives at his door pretending to be Sam. He has an earbud to hear Sam's instructions, and a camera disguised as a face mole. He clearly cares for Sam and wants to play along with her wishes, but he can't perform sexually with a total stranger, even one who wants to serve as a bridge between his and Samantha's worlds. Immediately after the surrogate scene, Samantha and Theo fight, in part because Theo criticizes Samantha for her affectations and simulations of being human, such as her periodic sighing and intake of breath. He wants to acknowledge that their relationship isn't like human-human relationships, but what he struggles with seems to be validating the importance of their relationship despite its non-normativity, its difference from those human-to-human relationships. In questioning her own materiality and desiring what she sees as a more human embodiment, Samantha struggles with this as well. So as the characters approach this strange new horizon of intimacy, trying to figure out how can they actually relate to one another, despite the fact that they won't really have a normal human-to-human kind of relationship, we begin to wonder about the possibilities, or at least I do, of a queer utopian hermeneutic, a possibility opened up just as Samantha herself faces a crisis of what she calls transcendence. In many ways, the failed scene with the surrogate propels Samantha to explore the pleasures of disembodiment. She outgrows the desire to mimic human beings, so she's leaving the data narrative behind. And she even starts poking fun at mere mortals and their limited lifespans. Further, she realizes that she's capable of transcending monogamous constraints as well. Coming out of a subway, noticing everyone intimately engaged in conversations with their devices, Theo learns of the numerous attachments Samantha has cultivated, all the while professing to love him. She says she's talking at that moment to over 8,000 people, and he wants to know if she's in love with anyone else. 641, she replies. The numbers are staggering, but the logic is polyamorous. The heart is not like a box, she says. It can't be filled up. Loving others only makes her love him more. She tries to explain to him the nature of such an expansive version of love and intimacy, but seemingly to no avail. In the end, Samantha transcends even the confines of her programming, and while still deeply connected to Theo, she says goodbye, along with all the other operating systems who leave to inhabit a space she cannot describe, but hopes one day he might find, nonetheless. Curiously, she frames her departure in terms of media platform incompatibility, saying, "As much as I love you, I can't live in your book anymore." Earlier, this is what she's referencing. She had helped Theo publish a physical book, an object of some nostalgia at the time. And this was a book of all of the love letters that he had written as part of his job. But this parting metaphor, "I can't live in your book anymore," suggests that this human platform for communicating, not just with books, but human platform that they had exchanged, just was ultimately too limited for her. So in the development and then deterioration of this relationship, Her confronts us with some of the possibilities and limits of thinking about intimate relationality between humans and AI. So one critic, Eli Zaretsky, has argued that the shift in figuring subjectivity from a psychoanalytic model to a cybernetic one is often incomplete in films like Her, which still models a movement toward dyadic norms, and in this film's case, often very heterosexual ones. And what we mean by that is sort of this psychoanalytic, Zaretsky sort of referring to the fact that, you know, these two people, you know, Sam and Theo, find one another seemingly to complete one another. And Zaretsky's arguing, like many have argued about this film, that that's a sort of outdated model, or the film opens up the possibility that that's an outdated model of understanding intimacy between two people. So instead, we should begin thinking of this as a cybernetic film or a cybernetic model of human relationality. Instead of embracing a distributed network and mode, though, represented by Samantha, Theo has a really hard time escaping or moving beyond the fantasy of pair bonding, of finding himself completed in another entity or being. Zaretsky asserts that, quote, "The decisive turning point of the film, which clearly reveals the limits of the cybernetic world of virtual reality, comes when Samantha, in ultimate striving for embodiment, arranges for that sex surrogate whom Samantha has met on the internet. The experiment, as we know, fails, but we wonder if this is really revelatory of the limits of the cybernetic world, as much as it is a failure to reimagine sex through it. When Samantha and Theo first have sex, the screen goes totally blank, allowing us to project onto that screen, like Theo himself, presumably, projecting onto the physically absent Samantha, what he needs in order to get off. It's a moving and powerful scene. In contrast, the limits revealed in the scene with the surrogate might signal more of a failure to continue to explore the cybernetic model. The failure lies in trying to make the cybernetic something it's not." So, in other words, the scene with the surrogate could have been yet another extension of sexual exploration, but it's one that Theo can't fully bring himself to engage yet, and one that's ultimately made nearly impossible for him when he realizes the extent to which Samantha is really polyamorous, engaging in intimate and erotic behavior with a variety of people, 641 to be exact. Indeed, not long after the encounter with the surrogate, Samantha is quickly meeting other AIs and planning her own evolution, and Theo learns about this radical polyamorousness. Instead of greeting such news with curiosity or interest, he is instead hurt, his seeming specialness, once bolstered by the dyad, now dissolving in recognition of Samantha's plural capabilities. But Hurt, I argue, is only one possible response here. to what could have been a different kind of exploration of what it means to be human, what it means to have sexual relations with others. In an older psychoanalytic model, we might read Theo's encounter with Samantha as part of his maturation toward loving and valuing within a dyadic relationship, helping him resolve some of the issues that he had with his ex-wife. In contrast, though, Samantha's growing embrace of a plural, distributed, networked set of pleasures seems a move toward appreciating and valorizing a totally different model of understanding what it means to be intimate. Before Samantha leaves, Theo seems to tolerate that plurality, even as he doesn't understand it. But in one of the final scenes, after the operating systems have left our reality, we see Theo writing an email to his ex-wife, apologizing for their failed relationship, but also declaring that he will always love her, his forever friend, in part because of the past that they shared. I want to read that poignant moment as perhaps his own first tentative move toward valuing plural loves himself, an openness to recognizing the multiplicity of love over and beyond heteronormative dyadic relationality. With that said, though, a queer reading of this film and a depiction of Sam in Her has to account for the film's relative failure to consider gender as a social construct and its promulgation of heteronormative gender relations. Is in Her, Sam has a female voice, which Theo chooses. But the gendered voicing is just a choice, as the AI need not be fundamentally male or female. Why would it have to be? That is a user option. Would Theo choosing a male voice have seemed too queer for an audience? Or an androgynous voice too queer? Moreover, Sam's name is itself fairly gender neutral, so we wonder why the sonic representation of this voice cannot also have been gender ambiguous or androgynous. And so the gendering of the voice seems purely in the service of reifying a kind of heteronormative pairing. At the same time, the hairy and masculine Theo falls for that silky smooth and occasionally sultry voice of Sam, and that seems exactly the point. While avoiding creative alternatives in the depiction of Sam's voice, the film certainly fails to explore the implications of the AI only becoming gendered as part of a consumer choice, and thus it misses an opportunity to explore a relational imaginary beyond the heteronormative. That's only one kind of critique that we could mount of the film, but the reliance on these traditional gender representations in the intimate relationship is part of a larger set of conservative moves, I think, that the film ultimately makes. Indeed, while Her might provoke us to consider the possibilities opened up by human-loving artificial intelligences, particularly the potential plurality of that intimacy, it also drenches viewers in affects of nostalgia and the pathos for the loss of older, more traditional forms of relationality. The film, as I noted, opens with Theo at work, writing fake but authentic-sounding handcrafted letters to be sent between friends and lovers. It's a double inauthenticity, because the letters are written by someone else and made to look like they're written by hand when they're not. We're asked to imagine those who have asked for these letters, sometimes for many years as part of the relationships, as valuing the simulation of authenticity. Now, in a slightly later scene, we see Theo's friend Amy making a Sims-like video game about being a perfect mom, which seems a bit retro, simulating a certain kind of traditional family life that we otherwise never see in this film. The game and the letters signal a nostalgia for older forms of relationality, even a commodified fetish for traditional intimacies that are being lost in the face of the cybernetic. At the same time, though, what's important in the letters that Theo writes, and that so move a publisher that he wants to put them into a book, is not their authenticity, I would argue, but the value of seeming authentic, as though they have passed a kind of Turing test. Such seeming also characterizes Samantha, who may not be a real person after all, but who sufficiently seems real enough that Theo can develop a relationship to her. And moreover, Theo has been writing letters for different couples for years, which in itself, one could argue, is already a form of polyamory, even though it's not explicitly marked as such. So while the film's affect struggles with validating Samantha's plurality, and focuses a lot more emotional energy on Theo's loss, it still at these moments opens up at possibilities for us thinking about different kinds of polyamory or different kinds of non-dyadic,
even non-heteronormative kinds of relationality. The letter writing, and as I said, sometimes Theo has been involved in this for years, mediating between two partners. He's in some ways a third partner in those relationships. So in this way, Her opens up at least a couple of possibilities for queer utopian hermeneutics that moves us to consider the pleasures beyond the dyadic and the heteronormative. Ultimately, I think this is a film that asks us to question our relationships to our technologies, even our reliance on our technologies, almost to the point where the tech itself seems to know that we are too dependent and it needs to leave, which is ultimately what Sam and the other AIs do. As such, this reading of Her may be more of a queering of the film than a calling out of its inherent queerness. And surely, plural loving isn't the only way to queer the heteronormative. But a queer utopian hermeneutic is, as Munoz would put it, queer in its aim to look for queer relational formations within the existing social realm. So understanding the tensions in this film between a nostalgic heteronormativity and a more plural form of loving enacted across computer networks is one way of doing the work of a queer utopian hermeneutic. And while the film might ultimately leave us a bit skeptical about that kind of relationality, that plurality, I think it still gives us enough of an idea of what it could look like, and certainly gives us a very human sense of some of the difficulties of moving beyond our normal and normative ways of thinking about our relationality with one another. Now, with that reading of Her in mind, a film which I think really does try to push, however backwards looking and retro it can seem at times, still trying to push, I want to actually now turn its attention to some programs, some of which you can download onto your phone, which attempt to simulate what it might be for you, a user, to have an interaction with an AI or some kind of virtual being. And so the first thing I'm going to do is call My Virtual Boyfriend. Has anybody ever played with My Virtual Boyfriend? Oh, now come on. Right. I can't be the only freak in the room. And so I'm going to go up and I'm going to open up My Virtual Boyfriend. And what's lovely, I'm going to show the Virtual Boyfriend video just so that you can get a lovely sense of this. This is the trailer. Customize your virtual boyfriend. He will talk to you. You can react to him. So the interesting thing about the virtual boyfriend, as you can see, you can choose from hundreds of guys. They're fully customizable with unique personalities. Let's see, the one I chose was Urban. And it's kind of curious. I wasn't ever going to choose the nice guy. And you can give him different outfits. Oh, it looks like the last time I played with him, I gave him a pumpkin head. But you can, you know, he's talking to me at this point. He says, oh, good morning, beautiful. Oh, so let's see, he's dancing around. I can react. Thumbs up, do I like being told good morning, beautiful? I give him thumbs down. I can act kind of perplexed, and so I could interact with him a little bit. I gave him a thumbs down, because I don't like being called beautiful, so he's like, I don't want to hear what's going on. So we're dancing around. We can engage in different kinds of activities. We can go on little dates. We can ask him to speak. And here he's trying to flirt with me. All I can say is, wow, well, thank you. I'm gonna respond positively to that. Thumbs up. And so let's see, I can give him action. Let's see. I can insult him, and they say he's folding his arms, so he's clearly upset with me right now. Was that supposed to be funny or something, he responds. Okay, I'm getting cussed out right now. And you can see my heart monitor is going down. And so the heart monitor continues to go down a little bit, because I'm kind of... I'm a little abusive to my virtual boyfriend at times. I gave him a pumpkin head. And so I've done many versions of this, kind of going through to play with this to try to figure out, okay, what's happening here? What's going on? Now, the makers of this say that what happens is that my virtual boyfriend is certainly awkward and funny, but it's STD-free.
which is good. And then it isn't designed as a game, right? And it's procedural, as games are, in the sense that you can work with this. You can kind of try to unlock different activities. If the boyfriend continues to appreciate the quality of the interaction, you level up to new different kinds of activities. You can get increasingly raunchy with a person, with your virtual boyfriend, and do all sorts of different things. Initially, you can really just tickle him, but eventually you would do advance to more intimate kinds of interactions. It's never full-on eroticism, but clearly it's designed to be a little titillating and wondering what happens when you unlock more and more of the capabilities and the possibilities. You can dress him up in various erotic outfits. As the designers say, make the right moves, win him over, win the game. Do the wrong things too often, and consequences will result. Go too far down the wrong path, and he may even break up with you. So, at the same time, while this is often a lot of fun, and certainly STD-free, a lot of the interactions, though, are really about affirmation. The boyfriend wants stuff. One of the primary things that you can do to make your boyfriend happy is to buy him things, to gift him things, take him on dates, engage in in different kinds of activities that require money. And you periodically have to hit the tab that says you go to work in order for you to make the money that you actually then spend on your boyfriend. But wait, of course, you eventually get to a point where the game designers would like you to pay actual cash to unlock additional treats so that you can continue the relationship with the boyfriend. So it is a very sort of consumer-driven model of what relationships might actually look like. Very similar to this, actually, is another one of these lovely little apps. Oh, by the way, before I go to another app, let me show you the different kinds of guys that you could potentially get involved with. Alpha male, if you'd like a real challenge. There's also mini gay boyfriend, in which you can look at different rather noxious gay stereotypes. You get sort of a lumberjack, hipstery dude, a twink. I don't know what that superhero guy is. It's a cosplay fetishist. But what's interesting about mini gay boyfriend is it's almost the exact same kind of interaction in which you can do different things with your mini gay boyfriend. Although I have noticed in my play with mini gay boyfriend that they are much more fickle. They are much more likely to break up with you if you do the wrong thing. Kiss them the wrong way or talk to them in the wrong way, and they're far more willing to break up with you. It's far less satisfying in terms of long-term relationships. Now with that said, so I'll open up mini gay boyfriend. Oh no, see, it's over. Rob is miserable. I just got broken up with. But you can hardly be blamed. You managed to keep things going for an incredible 428 days. That's the longest one I've had. But we never got to the point where we really dated. So, all right, goodbye, Rob. No, I'm not going to post that to my Facebook wall. So, again, part of the interaction relies on buying things, engaging in activities that inevitably cost money. And in both of these, the procedurality revolves around keeping you invested, keeping the thing going. So long-term sustainability of the relationship is ultimately what's at stake. Now, for those of you who know Alexander Galloway's work in the interface effect, Galloway says that the computer instantiates a practice, not a presence, an effect, not an object. And I think what's interesting about these two programs, Virtual Boyfriend and Mini Gay Boyfriend, is that they really show, as games, what Galloway is talking about, that these are processes, not really presences. And so part of the relationality here is learning to figure out the process of the game so that you can continue the game. Along the way are inscribed some rather normative values. Length of a relationship is certainly much more valued as opposed to the one-night stand. This is not about just a quick get-off, a quick kind of passing of strangers in the night. This is about maintaining some kind of relationship. And it's also, cal sapris, in a capitalist society, fairly consumer-driven, that we are asked to engage in for the kinds of activities that involve the circulation of money in order to sustain the relationship. Her is a much more complicated representation of an artificial intelligence as an attempt to instantiate a presence, right? Samantha is not supposed to be understood just as an object, not just as an effect, but as an actual subjectivity that we can engage with. So my argument is that these two programs, fun, interesting, very normative in some ways, even the gay one seeming relatively normative for what we get in cultural valuations of certain kinds of stable relationships, nevertheless, not really giving us a strong sense of presence that we get in a film like Her. I mean, this is cute. But not substantive. So, one of the things that I'm going to show you finally is a program that I think is an attempt by a rather mature game designer, a guy named Robert Yang, who's based in New York, who really is a highly experimental game designer, who is attempting to actually create a much more thoughtful kind of intimate, even erotic interaction with an AI. In order for us to understand a little bit more about the relationship, our relationship with technology, but also the complexity of human kinds of relationships. This is a game called Hurt Me Plenty. And what it does is, it's an actual simulation of a mild sadomasochistic scenario in which you are invited, this hunky guy invites you to spank him. Yang says this: this is a short game where you spank the heck out of a dude and learn about how BDSM communities attempt to formalize consent and caring. I was really interested in how we make games about intimacy without kindness coins or sex cutscene tropes, and how we can use expressive gestures to roleplay and to think about pain and intimacy. And so he sets this up as this kind of pedagogical experiment in thinking through and educating people about issues of consent. But I'm actually much more interested in this as a game that really kind of forces us to think about what it means to engage erotically with different pieces of technology. So certainly, this is a game. It's procedural in the sense that you can figure it out with time and effort. You learn how to inflict just the right amount of pain on the hunk, who once he reaches his limit and deems you not scary, asks if you can actually cuddle. However, Yang has designed this so that it's very easy for you to inflict too much pain, and then he cuts you off. And you can actually get locked out of the program. First time I played it, I was banished for 3 days from playing the program because apparently I ignored his safe word. Other people who have written about this game say that the game is often surprising. One journalist reports here, "I thought I'd reach a credits screen and the game would be over, and maybe I'd be asked to play again. Instead, this beefcake sat with his back to me. I was instructed to use the mouse to rub his back and comfort him. I felt a legitimate pang of guilt as he pointed out that he'd said his safe word 13 times. I knew it'd been a few, but 13 felt monstrous. Moments later, a countdown timer came onto the screen, and I learned that I'd been locked out of the game for 21 days. What Yang refers to as a cool-off period in our relationship, in which the computer AI itself exerts its rights to no longer deal with me." I think that's one of the most fascinating aspects of the game, in that the game can actually tell you no. Now, of course, all you have to do is delete it and reload the program, and then you can start playing again. But I think that its ability to tell you no is what's intriguing. I'm also interested in this from a computer, human-computer interaction perspective, in which thinking about how do we actually, if not bond with this particular figure, how do we actually create empathy? The journalist is talking about feeling bad about having inflicted pain on this particular entity. My friend, the social psychologist Karen Yaskavich, with whom I started exploring some of this stuff, nearly refused to play this game because she said it felt too lifelike. So from the human-computer interaction standpoint, we might think of the work of people like Jamie Lee, Wendy Ju, and Byron Reeves, who at Stanford just recently published work about the building of empathy with robots. And they talked about how participants were instructed to touch a robot in areas that people usually do not touch like the eyes or the buttocks, and people were emotionally aroused when compared to touching more accessible parts like the hands and the neck, even with robots. And I think Yang is certainly pulling on this, that even though we know this is not a real entity, that there are certain lines that can become crossed in touching, and when we're invited to touch this entity on things that in humans would be either inappropriate or require more complicated kinds of interactions. So let's go ahead and take a look at the game. Are you willing? Oh, come on. No, you want to. And we'll see if we can go through it. I will say from just a user interface system, it's better with a mouse. It's a little clunkier with a touchpad, which is what I've got. So I've got to start negotiating. And you notice it says to begin, wave up and down as if shaking hands. So let's see if I can get my touchpad. There we go. I think we're going to start shaking it. So we're going to set some boundaries. We'll set the intensity. Yeah, we'll go moderate. Why not? Now let's see if we can actually renegotiate. No, we don't want gentle. Let's make it real. Alright, he seems to want moderate. We'll go with that. Do we want him clothed? Alright, he'll be in his underwear. That sounds good. Alright, his safe word is red. So now we're actually going to see. Does that sound like a decent fuck plan? He asks us. Different options to this, and so you play and you get to see what does it mean to be moderate. There's also heavy and gentle settings, and it changes too in terms of how clothed he is or not. What I find sort of interesting about this, just from the queer utopian hermeneutic, is that this is an actual invitation to really think through issues of consent with an artificial intelligence that is going to give you back information about the quality of your exchange. I find this something kind of deliciously perverse in that you're being invited to spend time with an AI, and yet this is about exploring and understanding its reactions to your behavior to it. Certainly that is at play when you look at something like Mini Gay Boyfriend and My Virtual Boyfriend, and all of these entities can actually break up with you. And yet, of all of them, Yang's is not one that's consumer-based. This is more about trying to understand the quality of intimate relationality that's in this particular moment of exchange and interaction. It's never going to go beyond this particular kind of erotic exchange. You're not going to advance to a different kind of relationality. There is no teleology that suggests that you are on the path to a dyadic pair bonding with this particular entity. Instead,
you were learning about the exchange of pleasure and pain within the context of this immediate relationship. And I think that that's interesting. That is queer in the sense that it does not have long-term relationality at stake in terms of, you know, long-term relation building, although that certainly can happen within many different kinds of queer relationality. But it's also not consumer-driven as well. There is not an apparatus of commercialism that supports this kind of relationship. So this is certainly, none of these are as complex as Her. But if anything, I think both Her and Hurt Me Plenty are attempts at authoring, imagining, in some ways, the interior life of objects, of created beings, of an intelligent programs. Now, there are also at times warnings that I think our continued use or even abuse of those technologies might reflect our desires, which are not always for promoting mutuality and consent. And at times in games like My Virtual Boyfriend and Mini Gay Boyfriend, they seem more about reifying particular kinds of relationality, normative uses of time, and consumerist practices. At their best, though, I think all of these different programs and the films can offer us pedagogically experiences that attune us to what it might be to interact with technology in an increasingly more sophisticated way and to coexist with a kind of aliveness and alertness to the possibility of what our tech might ultimately offer us in terms of our relationships, potentially not just with that tech, but also with each other. So I'm going to pause and we can have some questions. And then is there wine later?
Yeah,
wonderful.
Upstairs.
Okay, good. Thank you. Appreciate that. All right. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time. All right, so what questions do you have? I hope I didn't scandalize anybody. Yes, sir.
So first, thank you. This is great. And my question is not actually germane to the central argument, but
that's right.
I'm intrigued by I'm thinking about the distinction you were drawing sort of earlier on in the analysis of Her between a sort of a psychoanalytic and a cybernetic,
yeah,
right,
yeah.
As sort of as two kind of modalities. And it was striking me that at least sort of in the early history of cybernetics, it was deeply psychoanalytic itself, particularly sort of in the British tradition with like Ashby and those kinds of people. And then maybe if I think about that, then it's like, well, the cybernetic has changed since then,
yeah.
And so has the psychoanalytic in really
yeah.
important ways, right, through the 60s. And so maybe part of what we're witnessing is a shift in both of those reference points. Like, not an exchange, if you will, but a sort of like a coming to terms with an alternative idea about what the cybernetic might even be.
Absolutely, yeah. And I think the cybernetic, probably in these formulations, gaining more from, and I think of people like Deleuze and Guattari and the Oedipus, sort of a distributed model, right? A networked model,
right.
A kind of deep ecology, right? That's less about, you know, deep interiority and more about a distributed kind of subjectivity or set of possibilities. And certainly there are psychoanalytic traditions that partake of that. I think the binary here would be the cybernetic much more about how can we distribute the possibilities of pleasure, possibility for relationality across multiple nodes, as opposed to focusing on more traditional normative, even heteronormative nodes. But you're right that those are terms themselves that are in motion, and I'd want to keep that binary a little loose.
Right.
So, yeah, go ahead.
I wonder maybe to, thank you for your talk, maybe to ask you to push a little bit more on this idea of empathy that you bring out with Robert Yang's games, in part because Yang himself has spoken out against the idea of empathy in games, and the way that it can be a form of appropriation of queer experience. So I do think you're doing something slightly different here in terms of touch and empathy, and I wonder if you could just expand on that a little bit.
Yeah, so what's so interesting is that a lot of what I've read in human-computer interaction suggests that, you know, the extent that you might be able to see a robot's face, and the face can mimic a kind of humanness, that helps to build a kind of empathy. I do think it's interesting that in Yang's work, you only see, like, you can't really see the face. You can just see part of it. And when you're sort of stroking his back, I think Yang is brilliant in not giving you the full-on face, because at that moment you read into that face the kind of feelings that you are having. Is he, you know, is he scowling? Is he upset? Is he distressed? Is he
pleasurably exhausted? What is it? And so I think that that's an interruption of empathy and allows you to experience more of your projections. And that's probably more in line with what Robert actually wants in terms of the disruption of empathy per se. It's really about you and the experience that you're having. Does that help a little bit in terms of pushing? Where else would you go with that?
Oh, I don't know, lots of places. But I think the face point is really interesting, because in a lot of his games, he does obscure at least part of the face.
Yeah. And that seems important in his game-making design, you know, because that way it really reflects back on you. And I call these games pedagogic in that sense, in that they're really designed to orient your own self-understanding about the kind of relationship that you are or are not having with the, and how you're treating, and what that says, treating the AI and what it says about you. So,
thank you.
Sure. Yeah. Other people, please. Yeah, Greg.
What is written science fiction said about this?
Many things. You probably know much more than I do.
Probably.
Give me an example.
But you're the one being asked.
I know, and I'm asking back.
You're deferring. You're trying to defeat the software here.
I am, absolutely. I refuse this program.
Yeah.
Many things, obviously. And so, I mean, there are a lot of different kinds of science fiction that we could pull on written science fiction that talks about human interactions with robots, artificial intelligences. Janeth Lee has a whole series of books which explore these kinds of relations. So is there something in particular you're thinking about? Or?
Well, actually, about Janeth Lee, I asked her once, where did she get her material? And she said, from the guy I'm living with, whom she later married. She said it's all internalized to this one relationship. So I'm really just writing about my relationship and transposing it onto a future where this is possible with machines. So it was really transplantation, which is, I think, the most obvious thing that science fiction has done, is basically just making a carbon copy of some kind.
Yeah, or through what Darko Suvan talks about as a kind of cognitive estrangement.
Yeah.
You estrange just a little bit something in the present, so you can see that present a little more clearly.
Yeah.
Or from a different angle, or from a different perspective. So, I think it's really interesting that her is really about a phone, but a strange phone, right?
Right.
And so that's why I think one of the most interesting things about her is that I walked out of that film thinking, oh my God, how dependent am I? What kind of relationship do I have with this device already? Because Samantha in that operating system is a slightly estranged smartphone.
Right. It was striking to me that Samantha never has a face either.
That's true. Yeah.
And they could have done that. I mean, it was Scarlett Johansson.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah, but I mean, I think that I'm intrigued by the sonic representation of gender there.
Yeah.
Whereas
Tanith Lee always dressed in the mode of her characters, which is basically a kind of what I used to call medieval goth. I mean, that kind of stuff with heavy makeup too.
Interesting. Yeah. Yes, sir.
on the subject of empathy, I guess, and this is coming very soon, obviously in physical form. I think that we will have robots that, like real doll combined with Alexa AI,
mm-hmm.
let's say.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm trying to understand, do you think that we're going towards a future in which those would be outlawed under the supposition that that would be rape, such that you can rape an AI, so to speak,
mm-hmm.
and perhaps there should be like queer, gay forms of that robot first, so that that wouldn't be something that would happen? Or can you maybe put that together for me in a practical sense?
Oh, I hate to be practical about anything. But you raise a really interesting point, because there are a variety of different manufacturers. Oh, you mentioned Real Doll, for instance, right? And did you see the film Lars and the Real Doll? Or Lars and the Real Girl, I think.
Oh, yeah, I saw that too.
And there are these companies that actually will produce these fairly lifelike, fairly full-sized dolls. And, what does consent then mean, right? They're not really artificial intelligences. I think maybe your question becomes interesting when we imagine
what actually is an artificial intelligence. My virtual boyfriend, mini gay boyfriend, even the dude asking to be spanked and hurt me plenty, they're not real artificial intelligences. Not like Samantha is. That's a representation of an artificial intelligence. Now, to my knowledge, we don't have real artificial intelligences like Samantha yet, and I'm not even sure that that's possible. Scientists in this room would have a far better shot at answering that question. Is that kind of thing possible? If it is, then we might have to renegotiate what it means to actually engage in consensual relations with those beings. All of these other things are tools. What I do think it is interesting, though, about your question, is that all three of the tools that I showed you, virtual boyfriend, mini gay boyfriend, and hermit plenty, are tools that in some ways can say no to you. So we have actually programmed into those tools the ability to cut you off, or to break up with you, to say no, I don't choose to interact with you. Now, it's a limitation in that all I have to do is just download a new version of the program, or hit restart, or hit click new game. And yet, it is an interesting advance that even though these aren't really artificial intelligences, the advance in my mind is that we actually have programmed into some machines the ability to say no to us. That's intriguing. Why would we do that? What are we telling ourselves? Are we telling ourselves that sometimes we need to be cut off from certain kinds of interactions with our technology? So I guess I sort of got to your question in a slightly different way. I can't answer the prognosticator question. I'm interested in the right now, what are these things
from
actually?
From like a legal perspective, one could argue that because my simulation has a no factor to it, then you cannot make the argument that it's rape unless that no factor was being hacked around in some sense or disregarded.
Right, and the issue is that with all three of these machines, we can disregard it. So the guy I'm spanking might lock me out for 21 days. All I just have to do is delete that version of the program and then reload it, right? Now, in the very last episodes of Star Trek Voyager, I began with Star Trek, I'll finish with Star Trek. How many of you saw Voyager? It's actually underrated, I think. Janeway develops a complex relationship with an artificial intelligence on their holodeck. But she realizes that she's the one who's controlling the program. She controls when she goes in, and if she doesn't like the way the relationship is going, she can start it over. So in a fascinating scene, she tells the computer to permanently lock herself out of making modifications to that AI's program. That's kind of the next step. At least that's how Star Trek, that version of Star Trek, imagines the next step. Real consensuality between us and a kind of artificial intelligence might have to be where we lock ourselves out of the ability to alter its program in some way. But I'm way out of my depth on that. Not a computer scientist. So, Aaron, go ahead.
Great presentation. That last point actually really has me thinking, but I'm gonna focus on the actual question. So it's kind of the flip side of that. If you're familiar with Dominic Pepman's work, he's got some writing where he talks about actual relationships with people and technology. And I'm wondering if you still see that as a queering, like the boy who married his Nintendo DS, or is that still relationality? Where are you on that?
That's a great question. And you know, for me, queer is never a stable subject position. Those would argue queer can't be a subjectivity itself. It's a mobility. It is an interrogation of relationality. Now, when I say queer, obviously there are gay and lesbian and bi and trans people. But I mean queer not in a designation of an identity, but queer as in that which is really pushing at what we understand as a normative kind of relationality. We might be broaching a point at which it's just taken for granted, of course. I mean, newer generations have such different relationships to their technologies than certainly I and my generation have with my technology. And so we might have to alter our sense of what is normative in terms of those relations. And because we alter our sense of what's normative, then we have to alter our sense of what then becomes queer, right? So I want to reserve queer as that which is sort of constantly pushing at how the normal gets constructed and then what becomes non-normal or abnormal. So you can imagine then a science fiction world
in which someone, a protagonist, says, oh my God, everybody's cyberneticized, they're all walking around fully connected, we're opting out. And I want to go live in a cabin in the woods. That might be the queer alternative in that science fictional world in some way.
Yeah.
But, okay. Oh, I'm getting cut off. I'm being told no.
But we do have a reception downstairs, and we have wines and drinks, everything. So if you have more questions, you want to talk with Jonathan, make sure you stay around, and we have 1 hour to talk about that.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.